Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Stellar Shows at Jack's. This presentation of Eclectic American Roots is a showcase for the music and lifestyle that celebrates the origins and legacy of authentic American music. Please give generously early and often as we present this new series. The proceeds go to connecting you with the Eclectic American Roots musicians that you love and encourages them with support through these challenging and uncertain times. I've been privileged for many years to be able to present the best in live roots music through Stellar Shows. Throughout the weeks to come, Stellar Shows remains committed to curating live talent, even with our clubs and venues shutting down, and all our performers being trapped in their homes. Roots music is all about taking entertainment back to a time when the words and the songs were much more meaningful compared to the overproduced music of today. And thanks to Jack's Entertainment, Stellar Shows at Jack's presents Eclectic American Roots. Hello, friends. You know, this is the part of the show I usually tell a coronavirus joke, but it would take you 2 weeks to get it. As the COVID crisis continues, so does our determination to raise money for our artists, the professional musicians who are still out of work and with no end in sight. We've created these e-broadcasts to entertain you, but also to support them. But unless you give, they may not make their rent payment, their car payments, or their grocery bills. So I'm asking you to please dig deep this week and share this episode. Our musician friends live all over the world, but we pay them an equal share of the donations received immediately, regardless of whenever you make that donation. So all that being said, welcome to our show, Ladies of the Rockabilly Scene. It's a vivid and glamorous world of cool kittens and vivacious vixens. Rockabilly is a worldwide phenomenon whose followers don't just occasionally sample the lifestyle, they are living it. Today's ladies of the rockabilly scene are throwbacks who still live like it's 1950, and their cars, clothing, and musical choices reflect that. Everybody's heard of the most famous of the rockabilly stars, Buddy Holly, Jerry Lee Lewis, Eddie Cochran as examples, but there are some very talented females who have not only helped launch the rockabilly scene, but are currently creating original music and expanding their universe. There's a good argument to be made that the earliest and the best rockabilly performers were women. You may never have heard of Sister Rosetta Tharpe, but her impact on the music influenced a lot of male stars who came along later. Sister Rosetta Tharpe is the grandmother of rockabilly. All her musical elements are in place, from her hot picking guitar to the vocal swoops. Men who built their careers on Tharpe's guitar style include Chuck Berry, the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, and Elvis Presley too. Then there was Charline Arthur. She started out in a hillbilly boogie style, which basically means she was doing rockabilly before Elvis came along. And she even told everybody that rockabilly was what it was called. Her powerhouse voice was a big influence on Patsy Cline, among many others. Listen to Charline Arthur's Burn That Candle, and remember this amphetamine rhythm is all original. Nobody came before her to teach her how. Her fresh and brassy style pointed the way for many of today's artists to follow.
Burn that candle.
Like Charline Arthur, Rose Maddox was also hillbilly boogie, and when rockabilly came along, she and her brothers just kept on doing what they'd always done. Hey Little Dreamboat shows off Rose's blood harmonies with her siblings, the Maddox brothers, who she fronted until her solo career took off. She added 14 hits on Billboard's country singles charts.
Well, washed all the dishes and I did a lot more. I even bought the dinner at the grocery store.
Ruth Brown was singing rock and roll since the early 50s, and she was a big influence on performers like Wanda Jackson and Rose Maddox. Rockabilly is usually seen as a country-tinged offshoot of jump blues or rhythm and blues, and the song This Little Girl's Gone Rockin' from 1958 is built around a stinging electric guitar line that any rockabilly queen would be proud to call her own.
I'll see you later, mater. You'll find each thing that you want it done. I'm off to meet that special one.
Janis Martin was billed as the female Elvis for her dance moves on stage, but she was a great singer in her own right. She didn't have the overwhelming power of a Wanda Jackson, but with a rich, virile tone that makes bang bang into a double entendre even before you listen to the slightly suggestive lyrics. Now that you've seen the roots of rockabilly, ladies, and the music so many have loved and followed since the late 1940s, sit back and enjoy the rest of our show. We're going to kick it off with a classic from Kim Lenz and the Jaguars. That was Kim Lenz, one of the many rockabilly female artists Stellar Shows has presented over the years. Kim is a legend in Ladies of Rockabilly, and her history inspired us to create this special show. But to host a show like this, featuring multiple lovely ladies with a ton of talent, there was no debating over who would fit that bill. I have lost count of how many times Big Sandy and the Fly Right Boys have played at my Stellar venues, but I recall we almost renamed Don the Beachcomber's main showroom Big Sandy's Ballroom. He was there so often, and not always to perform. When Big Sandy's off the road, he frequents many musical establishments and usually has at least one pretty girl on his arm. Why? Because the dapper Big Sandy is an educated man. He graduated summa cum laude from the College of Rockabilly Knowledge. He majored in juke joint jumping. He holds a bachelor's degree in female anatomy, and he earned his master's in tequila tasting. As valedictorian of his class, his speech was all about international relations, his own. So it's with great expectations I introduce today's host, Big Sandy.
Hi, friends. Oh, your old pal Big Sandy here. We're going to have an excellent afternoon here as Eclectic American Roots presents the ladies of the rockabilly scene. We have Rosie Flores, Marti Brom, Ruby Ann, Amber Foxx, Celine Lee, Cherry Rat. And we're going to talk to Tom Ingram about some of the women he's booked over the years. Before we move on any farther, though, I tell you what, if you like any part of what we're doing here today or any of the series of shows that we've been doing, we ask you to please reach into your heart, share a little bit. That would help so much if you visit our virtual tip jar at stellarjacks.com. Without your virtual tips, this would be virtually impossible. Hey, And now, ladies and gentlemen, a young woman originally from Brazil who's bringing her music to audiences all around the world and has really been making a big name for herself. Welcome to our show, Ms. Cherry Rutt.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Cherry, I know you're originally from Brazil. Where are you coming to us from right now?
I am in Las Vegas. I moved here in 2016, and here I am.
Okay.
Don't intend to leave it.
But you started your musical career when you were still in Brazil. Is that right?
Yes. I started this band in 2010, actually. And at the beginning, it was just for fun. We were just playing some cover songs. And then after a few years, I decided to write my own songs. And now we're getting ready for the second album.
All right. Yeah. When you started this band, had you done any music at all before that? Or were you singing already? Or maybe in a family situation or in any way at all?
Yeah, I started singing at a church. My grandma made me go to the church. And the only fun there for me was singing. So I would sing there. And then after that, I had a couple of bands when I was a kid, just playing guitar and singing.
Okay.
And then when I was about 14 to 15, I had a punk rock band.
All right. Well, I think it's interesting that you mentioned the church, growing up in the church, because a lot of the original artists that a lot of us are inspired by, you know, some of the 50s acts, they all talk about growing up in the church, and that's where they first did their singing. But thinking of those original artists, are there any of the classic female rockabillies or rock and rollers that you found to be an inspiration when you were coming up?
Yeah, Janis Martin, I think she's my queen. I love her vocals. I love her songs because they're simple, but they're complex at the same time. I don't know if you can understand like
Absolutely.
What I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
And I think it's so beautiful. Like all the lyrics and everything, it just flows. It works so well together. Wanda Jackson, of course. Lori Collins. Brenda Lee. All of them, they're all influences to me.
And have you ever had a chance to work on some of the same bills or same festivals with any of those artists?
I opened for Wanda Jackson here in Vegas.
Really?
Yeah. If I had to like make a list of the five best moments of my life, this moment will probably be there. I never thought I would even see her playing. I saw her at Viva. I cried so much. I was like, oh my God, that's Wanda Jackson right in front of me. And I cried a lot. But then when I was invited to open her show, I didn't have words. I was speechless. It was fantastic. It was amazing.
Particularly with Wanda, she seems to be like such an inspiration to young women, not even just women singers, artists, but just a lot of the young ladies within the scene. As an artist who began a career in Brazil and now is living here in the States, in Las Vegas to be particular, do you find a difference at all in the audience? Maybe in the sort of like this, what they react to more than in one place than the other, or do you approach it differently, like an American audience than you would back home?
Yes, it's very different actually. When I got here, my first shows, I was so scared because back in Brazil, people, they go out to see live bands to have fun and dance. So most of the time they're not really paying attention.
Okay.
They are paying attention. They're listening to it, but they're having fun. They're dancing. They're talking. They're drinking. And here, people, they tend to pay attention more to the band and what they're playing, what they're singing, and if they like it or not. So they're always looking. So at the first moment, everyone was just staring at me like this. And I was like, oh my God. And like, is my English wrong? Like, is there something wrong? Like,
they might have been staring for other reasons.
Maybe, I don't know. But I was really scared. And now I see the difference. Like, people, they prefer here to watch, really watch the band.
Okay.
And I love it. I think it's great.
Well, Cherry, it's been really great talking to you today. But I tell you what, if you have your guitar handy, it'd be really great to hear a song from you. Could you do that for us?
Of course. I have my guitar right here.
I still remember things you said and all you've done, and all the love and nights I kept by my own. I am but a fool just begging you to stay. Why you such a rude and walk the door away? Now my heart is breaking, while your mind is shaking. Any difference making if you stay or go? Day by day you leave me hanging on the phone. Baby, I know that you are anywhere but home. I am but a fool just begging you to stay. What is done back just like it's the same. Now my heart is breaking, while your mind is shaking. Any love is saved if you're really alone. Over you, and it's ringing a bell low. Slowly get a voodoo hover down your feet, stuck you in the sand like a stone. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Well, you know the gun is crossing over you, and it's ringing a bell low. Stuck you in the sand like a stone. Whoa, whoa, oh. Whoa, whoa, oh. Whoa, whoa, oh. Whoa, whoa, oh.
Now, Cherry, for any of our viewers who'd like to get some of your merchandise or find out more about you, where would they go for that?
Oh, they can go to my website, www.cherryrat.com. And if you put /shop, you can see all my merchandise over there, or just click on shop. You're going to see everything over there.
Well, if I can say in that way, and with that approach, you are continuing on a tradition, because you think about those original artists, they were bucking the trend at the time too. They were taking, a lot of them came from the country field originally, and they were taking influences like rock and roll, rhythm and blues, that which they weren't supposed to do, and just moving forward with their own thing and creating a new sound, and that's what you're doing. So, Cherry Rat, thank you for being on the show. You've been a really lovely guest, and I hope we can include you in a future episode if you'd be willing to do that.
Of course, just let me know.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now, Eclectic American Roots would like to present a woman who has been a true breath of fresh air on the rockabilly scene, both with her music and her vivacious spirit. And also her support for other artists within the scene. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bad Bunny herself, Celine Lee.
Hello, everybody.
As I mentioned, you really have brought a breath of fresh air on this scene. I think it's just your person, just natural. Your personality, you seem to walk that line between being sexy, but also just down to earth, funny, and
I try.
Yeah, well, but the thing is that you don't try. It's just natural. Did you already have thoughts of wanting to be a performer, or did that come later
yeah,
on?
Yeah, I was in my grandpa's band every Sunday at the Croatian Club, and he would get me up to sing with him and his band. So it always was kind of just a normal thing for me as a kid to be on stage. And I didn't really get the guts to really get on stage and actually really think about being a singer until I actually moved to Las Vegas. And Viva Las Vegas just happened to be there. And I had always been into rockabilly music. They called it oldies music when I was growing up in high school. And I was the weirdo that liked oldies music while everyone else was listening to, you know, hip hop. And I mean, I still listened to that too when I was a kid. But that Patsy Cline and Johnny Cash were always on my radar, and I always had their records. And so when I moved to Vegas, I couldn't believe that there was people like me out there that were into rock and roll and rockabilly music. So I decided that I met my boyfriend out there at the time. He was in a rockabilly band, and we started singing songs together. And I said, you know, I'm just going to try this out. And if I suck, then nobody knows me out here. And then it all came crashing down in 2008. So I ended up leaving Vegas, and I moved back to Miami. I went to beauty school, and I started a rockabilly band, Billy and the Hellbillies.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I started doing that for fun, and I just always loved it.
And was it similar to the sort of sound that you're doing now? Celine and the Hellbillies, if we were listening to the music you were playing, if we were at a gig, what might we be hearing?
Well, it's so funny. I just actually found my first set list ever, and I posted it the other day. It was hilarious. And it was all Wanda Jackson.
Really?
And what was it? What else was it? Hank Williams, Jambalaya. And then I would write the little notes like, say this, and in between, and I did, there were, five Wanda Jackson songs on there, of course. I started a band called Celine Lee and the Brooklyn Three. And, and then I started I always had side bands where I would do it while I had my jobs as well.
So things you would do locally?
I would just do, just play at Auto Shrunken Head and Skinny
Dipping. Okay, yeah, yeah.
Thing. So, yeah.
You bring a lot to the table, and we wanted to put the spotlight on you a little bit. But I don't want to ignore it, though. But I think it's a great story. It's sort of become the stuff of legends, how you ended up meeting Dale Watson. Can you tell us a little bit how that came about?
Yeah. I did a tour in 2012 with this country band from Florida, and we went all up and down the whole East Coast, all the way up to New York and Cleveland, and we listened to Dale Watson on the whole tour. I hadn't heard of him at that time. I'd only heard maybe one song. And after I did end up moving to New York, the first week I moved there, Dale was playing at Hill Country Barbecue. And so me and my band, we decided to go check him out. We went there and we said, we love you. We love your music. We just got off this tour and we were listening to you the whole time. And he put his arm around me and we took pictures, and he's like, hey. He's like, what did he say? He said, you're a tiny little thing, aren't you? And so we just, he's flirting, you know. And then I was just like, stop it, you know, because I was kind of dating this other guy at the time. And the next day he messages me on Facebook, and he said that he's in New York and he wanted to take me out for dinner. He doesn't know anybody. He's in town doing a play. So I said, no. Absolutely not. And then I changed my mind and I went on a date with him, and it was very, very, very sweet. Uh-huh. So, but then back and forth, we just decided to be friends, and we started writing music together when he was in Texas, and we started texting lyrics, and he found this picture of me flipping the bird in my Playboy bunny suit, and he asked if he could put that on a record. And I said, yeah, sure, whatever. I didn't really think he was serious. So he's like, but we got to write the songs first. And then that's how all the songs that we wrote came about. Finally, after like 4 years, I decided that I'd let him take me out on a date, real date. And then we fell in love.
You know, so you and Dale developed this relationship, and you know, he has the Maripolitan Awards, you know, that whole organization going. And I think with your involvement,
I got thrown into it, and I'm
tell us about that.
You know,
okay, tell us about that.
When I first started dating Dale, it had just happened, so I was just his girlfriend, supporting, being there, and they were doing it in Austin, you know, and then all kinds of stuff happened, and I ended up being a big part of it and helping, and now I'm doing the fashion show and trying to book all the showcases and trying to just get everybody in there as much as possible, and it's been... It's a lot of work, for sure.
Well, I don't know how you do it. I got to peek behind the curtain, so to speak. And my goodness, I know there's a lot of work that goes into it. A lot of work that goes into making it look seamless and effortless, you know. But since you've been involved, it's just really blossomed into a wonderful thing.
It started as just like an award show, and it's become this beautiful weekender where people just come together and just celebrate the music that we all love, making beautiful music. And that's what it's all about, is celebrating the young artists that are...
Well, what I love is, Celine, I love that you spotlight the day who other people might not know about, but also... You draw attention to some of the originators, the founders of the sound, so to speak. And I believe it was in 2016 that you awarded Wanda Jackson the founder of the sound award. But first, just for the viewers at home, so they can understand what the founder of the sound. What is that exactly?
Well, it's like somebody like 2020. We did Dwayne Eddy. For instance, I mean, Dwayne Eddy is the guitar god who so many musicians and guitarists look up to for the sound that he originated and created. So Wanda, for instance, is the nice lady with the nasty voice.
Okay.
She started that growl, and, you know, so who else did we do? So many, Jerry Lee Lewis. You know, the year before, the same year. And it's just giving those artists that we all love the recognition that they deserve now.
Right.
Because they might have gotten it back then, but we want them to know when they're still here with us that we love them and how much of an impact that they have made on us.
So let's say Wanda's watching right now. Is there anything you'd like to tell her right now? That maybe let her know what she's meant to you over the years?
Oh, man, don't make me cry. I just, Wanda, if you're listening, I just want to thank you for everything that you've done for women, and not just women, people, musicians, and just everything that you've done. You were just a trailblazer, and I'm just so happy that you're here, and you've done so much for us. So I love you, Wanda.
Well, Celine, working with the Maripolitan Awards and being so closely associated with that, you've had to keep a close eye on the current crop of talent. Are there any young women that we should know about to keep an eye on?
Who you turned me on to, Johnny and Jaalene. Jaalene is amazing.
Oh, yeah, she's great.
She's really young, and she's got a voice, and I have been keeping up with her on social media because of you, Robert.
Yeah, she's super sweet, too.
Too good to be true.
We wish both you and Dale all the best through these the troubled times, you know, keeping the Hernando's Hideaway afloat. And I just urge everybody out there who's listening, watching, to support them. You know, I know you're working behind the scenes every Sunday with the chicken bingo and bringing a lot of joy to a lot of people. So keep up the good work, and let's keep in touch. Thank you so much, Celine. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, Miss Celine Lee.
Well, I headline now, I'm telling the truth. Well, your poetry, I pick up the boots, something out of shape. It's something out of shape. It's something out of shape. It's something out of shape. Said you weren't ready for truth, and still it's okay. Don't have to be a pro just to get up on your feet. Don't have to be a star just to get up from the sea. Girls, I know your man, it's love and it's true. All the ladies want to rock and roll the way they do. So let's stroll. Come on, ladies. As hot as any man, take some advice from me and take your buddy's hand. Gals, I know your man will have to wait. All the ladies wanna dance and shake to wave past late. Let's stroll. Come on, ladies, let's stroll. We can shimmy and shake and make the boys wait. Let's stroll.
Well, thank good God he feels me so. He's the apple of my eye. I can't lose, but you're so shy. But all I can say is, I get tongue-tied.
keep on knocking, but you can't come in. You keep on knocking, but you can't come in. You keep on knocking, but you can't come in. Come back tomorrow night and try it again.
Well, back when one sack honey pop, Bill and his comments rock around the clock. Jerry's got a 5 minute lady sang, Elvis hung around, told the world it thing. These days it's all about the play. This kind of noise makes my ears ring. Wanna hear the bass, still cry no more. Wanna sing blues till my throat is sore. Wanna play Wanda till the break of dawn. Gonna dance out on the front lawn. I don't mind if I'm on my own. Shake, shake, shake it loose. I don't want it to stop. Shaking in my boots. Now it's time to ride.
Do you have a dream tonight? Do you feel like dying? Oh, you know the wrong. Let me to turn that blind. No one to die. Take my hand and think everything you really. Because I need you. I know you need.
That man on my thinks I'm his living fool. I'm gonna show that child I've been through his old school. I've got to put my baby. Don't wanna put my baby down. Gonna put him down. Well, he looks so sharp. He tried to break my heart. Got to put him down. Yeah.
I think I'm being told that Celine is ready. She slipped away. She's okay. She says she's good to go. She put a new outfit on. She's telling me. I think maybe we'll see a little bit of Dale Watson in there too. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, Celine Lee.
Hey y'all. So this next song was recorded in 1966 on Capitol, and it is called "This Gun Don't Care."
I don't like the way you touch my baby. If you're smart, you'll turn him loose. Unless you crave danger or you're crazy. Cause this gun don't care who it shoots. You better take your hands off my baby, or they're gonna bury you in your boots. Heed what I say, cause I ain't fooling. Cause this gun don't care who it shoots. This old gun of mine has no conscience. Shows no favors, has never called a truce. So it's all up to you now, pay attention. Cause this gun don't care who it shoots. I'm glad to see you've made the right decision. Just back away, you'd better pull up roots. And let's hope that you never cross my vision. Cause this gun don't care who it shoots. This old gun of mine has no conscience. Shows no favors, has never called a truce. So it's all up to you now, pay attention. Cause this gun don't care who it shoots. No, this gun don't care who it shoots.
We love you, Wanda Jackson. Thank you, guys.
And now I'd like to introduce a sweetheart of the local rockabilly scene, a friend to one and all, in countries all over the globe. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Amber Foxx. Welcome, Amber.
Hey everybody, how you doing?
We're doing all right here. You're one of my favorite ladies of the Rockabilly scene.
Oh,
for sure. Thanks for spending a little time with us this afternoon.
Thank you for having me. I'm honored to be on this show. I was blown away when I saw who was going to be on the show today, and I'm going, wow, I'm part of this, because a lot of these women were people that I really looked up to when I started getting into the scene. So
was it 2002 when you first started your band as it is now?
Yeah, around 2002, me and Bob got hitched, and I was doing a lot of other types of music during that time before I met Bob, and he introduced me to the whole Rockabilly scene.
Oh, he brought you to this world, huh?
He absolutely did. He was like, he started playing upright bass for a while. Johnny Ray Bartell from the Knitters, he actually taught Bob how to play the upright bass. And so he started playing bass, and then Bob said, let's start this band. We can do this. And I'm like, all right.
Was there a turning point where you felt things sort of kicked off?
Well, yeah, I started seeing this guy, his name was Big Sandy, at the Doll Hut a lot.
All right.
And obviously we would go to Viva Las Vegas and do all that stuff. But he actually introduced me to Janis Martin. I really, really dug her stuff because I love jazz. Her influences were kind of jazzy, a little rock and roll, a little, you know, bad girl. And I really liked it. And then Marti Brom, like, we put on a couple of her records and I fell in love right away.
Whenever there's like one of the legends of our scene, you're right there in the front. I just wonder if you have any special memories of any shows that you were right there, right center stage watching.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, in 2006, I'll never forget the show that Tom Ingram put on. Ruth Brand and Janis Martin shared the stage together, and you were the MC. And it was an amazing show. I was younger, and I was at the front of everything. You could see me in this video. And Ruth Brand dropped her glasses, and I picked them up and handed them to her. And I thought that was like the coolest thing.
Wow.
unfortunately, I think a year after that show, Ruth Brand passed away. And then after that, Janis passed away. But to get to see that, these legends, it was amazing. It was a big deal for me.
So other than the passing the glasses back up to the stage, did you ever get to work on the same bill with either one of them, or find yourself on stage or with any of the original, the classic ladies of Rockabilly or rock and roll?
Funny story, before I got my start within Amber Foxx, really, I was playing the Doll Hut on Wednesdays for like three people just to get used to the stage presence. And we were at Viva Las Vegas one year, and Ruth Brand got sick. Ruth Brown, she got sick, she couldn't perform. And so I was asked to do this like all-stars thing when I had never performed more than in front of 50 people. So of course I peed my pants, and then, but this, it was cool because Bobby Trimble was playing drums for me at the time before he moved to Texas. And so they got together, and I was about to head out to go home. And they said, will you do this with Charlie Thompson, Big Sandy, Vicky Tafoya? And I seriously freaked out. I got red, and it was one of those really scary moments, but I'm like, what a great opportunity. So we performed that night. I drove home that night, which was crazy. But it really started off Amber Foxx for more opportunities. And then Tom Ingram booked me for Vegas the next year, which was like a huge deal.
Amber, you're one of the few who has the honor of being a nominee for the Maripolitan Awards. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit about what it was like getting that news and just that general experience for you?
Yeah, I was really blown away and so excited. I'd never been to Memphis, and I got to play on Beale Street. It was a beautiful experience for me. But I got the news. It was interesting. We were at Knott's Scary Farm. And I was running around with Doris Mayday.
Okay, yeah.
And I got this text saying, hey, we've nominated you. You know, the people have nominated you for this award. We'd love for you to come to Memphis, and we'd love for you to perform. And anyway, I was really blown away, and I was so grateful. And that was seriously such a good time. You guys all need to experience the Ameripolitan Awards. And you know, Anita, I'm sure you know who Anita is. She's one of my favorite all-time singers, you guys, from this era. So if you haven't looked her up, please do. I would love to have her nominated and come down to
it. Oh, she's fantastic, yeah.
Evening truly opened up a lot of opportunities. Following that gig at Viva that night, you know, I was asked to play Green Bay, Wisconsin, which was amazing. And then the Rockabilly Rave in England, I've played there a handful of times.
We know and you're the one of the few people I know from within the Rockabilly scene here in the States who was played down in Brazil. You ventured out over to Australia. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
I'm so grateful because, you know, me and my husband, Bob, who's been my bass player my entire career with Rockabilly, we have full-time jobs. So we seriously save our vacations to go perform in these countries, and then we get to see the world. So the music has really created these opportunities that I never thought would have happened in my entire life. So yeah, Brazil, like what? I got to tour Brazil.
I'm jealous.
Australia a couple times, and we stopped in China on the way to Brazil. And, you know, so we really take advantage of the travel. And then we get to go play music. So like, what kind of a life is that? That's amazing, right? I'm like,
Amber, speaking of Bob and speaking of playing music.
Yeah.
Do you think we could get the two of you to do a song for us here?
I would love that. I'm missing Tommy Harkerneider, my best man, playing guitar, but I think me and Bobby can do one, and he can do the slap bass. Here's one that we did that was actually, you know, I was part of the Ameripolitan Awards, which was really exciting. So this was one of the songs that was what for the nominees that we did, that we put out. So I think it'll be a fun one, a rockabilly tune. Come on, Bob.
Well, I hope you'll be my lover, boy, so tell you what I'll do. Well, I'll love you strong, I'll love you long, I'll be a slave for you. Just say you love me all the time, and I'll be true to you. And you said, okay, doll, it's a deal. And I said, okay, honey, it's for real. Well, you've got that certain love for love appeal. If you would only marry me, I'd be a happy girl. But I'll jump and sing when church bells ring. My heart'll be a whirl. Just buy a diamond sparkling bright and lots of lovely pearls. And you said, okay, doll, it's a deal. And I said, okay, Big Sandy, it's for real. Well, you've got that certain love for love appeal. And you've got that certain love for love appeal.
All right. Bravo, bravo. Amber Foxx, world. How about that?
How fun was that?
That was fantastic.
Like another two more hours. I really love
That was great. That's the personality and the joy that I feel from you when I see you perform. So it's good to hear you and feel you right now, Amber Foxx. And I know you just got back from a trip and not feeling the best right now. So thank you for being a trooper and stopping by with us here today. Amber Foxx, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm so grateful. Thank you. And thank you for Christopher for having me as well.
I mentioned earlier that there's a good argument to be made that the earliest and the best rockabilly performers were women. And one of those rockin' women was Wanda Jackson, who remembers the first time she ever saw a female entertainer when she was a teenager in the late 40s.
I remember seeing Rose Maddox and the Maddox Brothers.
Wild, wild young men like to have a good time. Wild, wild young men like to have a good time. Wild, wild boyfriends like to lose.
I was so young, I was about 7 probably, and I can't remember exactly what was in my head, but I do remember thinking, oh, I've got to do that. She looked so pretty. She was, had all this sparkle stuff on and singing, and they were so energetic. I mean, that was, for those days, it was very unusual, and it just excited me. And I said, I've got to be able to do that. And so I learned all of her songs, and she was very instrumental in my career, my singing style, because I liked her feistiness.
In 1954, at age 16, Wanda had a top 10 hit with the song You Can't Have My Love, which made her more determined than ever to pursue music. Here is her national television debut featuring that song.
You've got the clothes and everything to make you look just like a king, but you can't, no, you can't have my love. You've got a big automobile and a chauffeur at the wheel, but you can't, no, you can't have my love. Well, you think all you have to do is call and I will run to you, but listen while I break the news, I'm not the gal to shine your shoes. So with your money, loaded car, you ain't the cat you think you are, and you can't, no, you can't.
Back when Elvis was just starting his career, he took the time to counsel the young country singer Wanda Jackson to try rockabilly instead of country. Elvis proved to everyone that the young people are actually the ones that make hit records, because they buy them and then they pester the radio DJs to play them.
In 1955, Wanda Jackson was just out of high school, a young country singer ready to hit the road on her first tour, opening for a handsome young rocker from Memphis she had never even heard of. He thought her aggressive, bold voice was just right for the rockabilly style he was becoming famous for. Wanda listened to the advice that young Elvis Presley gave her, tried it on for size, and never looked back, becoming, in the process, the queen of rockabilly.
The bring him in, fill him up, sit him on the floor.
Early on in their careers, Elvis and Wanda shared shows together as they became innovators of the rockabilly sound. Their relationship was romantic for a brief moment in their lives, but the revolutionary sound they had developed from both a female and male perspective is what most notably makes their names synonymous. The pair toured together for 18 months and dated during that period. Elvis was a persistent suitor, and that led to this.
I was a good girl.
You were.
I was just kind of bad in my songs.
Jackson was a 17-year-old country singer in 1955 when she was booked to tour with a rising young star.
I'd never heard of him when I started working with him.
For a year and a half, she drove across the South with Elvis Presley, watching his career explode.
There was Elvis singing and gyrating, and all these little girls, oh, you know. And we'd never seen anything like that.
But Elvis had eyes for her.
He said, would you be my girl? I said, yeah, I would. And he reached in his pocket and he gave me this ring.
Were you surprised?
Yeah, I really was. He'd come get me and drag me to the wings of the stage to watch Johnny Cash. So that guy's going to be the biggest name in country music one day. And so he called that right.
In 1956, Jackson began recording rockabilly music, and with the release of I Gotta Know, a song that alternates between country waltz and rockabilly, had a number 15 chart success. Jackson's other early songs included Mean Mean Man, Hard-Headed Woman, and Fujiyama Mama, which was a number one hit over in Japan. Having achieved regional and national success, Wanda was being packaged with several other male entertainers to go out on tour.
They always had just one girl, and probably because there weren't that many girls. It seemed to be a man's field, and I never even thought about that when I entered it. You know, I just, hey, this is what I'm gonna do.
I love a mean, mean man who lives uptown. When I want him most, he's not around. He's a mean, mean man.
The radio DJs in that era were men who already had a hard time even accepting Elvis and Jerry Lee Lewis. So it was an even bigger uphill battle for Wanda Jackson, because she was a woman. It was near impossible for Wanda to get radio play and gain popularity. When Wanda first came out with rockabilly music, the DJs were not going to help a teenage girl sing this devil's music. They called it music from hell. But Wanda kept recording because she really wanted a hit record in that field, because she enjoyed singing it so much. But it wasn't until 1960 that she had a real hit. Let's Have a Party. That growl helped her to become the queen of rockabilly and the first true female rock and roll singer. In the early 80s, Wanda Jackson played and recorded rockabilly material whenever revivalists sought her out. She also toured Scandinavia, England, and Germany, embracing her rock and roll history. Jackson released the album Rockabilly Fever in 1984. Rock and roll. In 1995, guitar prodigy Rosie Flores contacted Wanda and said she'd like to have her sing a couple of songs on Rockabilly Philly, an album she was recording at the time. From there, Jackson found her way back to her rockabilly roots again, thanks to Rosie Flores, and it started a career revival for Wanda.
Just went crazy for Wanda Jackson and rockabilly music, and I just, like, she was just such an influence. She just changed my life, her singing style.
Well, I thought that you was a woman romance, but all you ever do is dance, dance, dance. So I bop and bop the whole night long with a knocked out rhythm of a jukebox song. But one thing I gotta know if my love's the real thing, where is my wedding ring? Well, we rock and roll till broad daylight. You're a little too cool to kiss your baby goodnight. I know you've had it, rock it through. I let you go home, what else could I do? Oh, one thing I gotta know. Well, if my love's the real thing, where is my wedding ring?
Over the past 60 plus years, Wanda has toured the world, had a lot of hits, and is now one of the most beloved ladies in the rockabilly scene.
These fans, I just get waves of love and acceptance, and I pick up on their energy. They know all my songs, they sing it with me and clap, and some just can't help it. They have to dance a little, and they're just fun to watch.
In 2011, White Stripes bandleader Jack White discovered Wanda Jackson, and they produced an album together. And when you know that Jack White is producing a Wanda Jackson album, you know it's going to be brilliant. He didn't only produce it, he played on most of the songs.
But we went everywhere, you know, went calypso and gospel funk and heavier rock and roll and blues and yodeling even at the end of the record. You know, so you've got so many different kinds of styles that Wanda takes on. And, you know, people, girls in their 20s aren't taking on that kind of material. So it's really interesting to hear her do it. Once we sort of broke open the idea that we were just going to do an all covers record and just see what we can do with how Wanda could attack those different genres, then I just tried everything, you know,
He brought some unusual songs to the table.
Yeah, yeah.
And I had to stop and really think about some. But he's got such a sweet way about him. He talked me into trying it. He stretched me.
Yeah.
Actually, what I've been saying, Jack, is that Jack pushed me and kept pushing until he pushed me right into the 21st century.
Jack White had the juice to score them a date on David Letterman, featuring the full band.
Our next guest is a true rock and roll pioneer who has come to be known as the Queen of Rockabilly. Her forthcoming album is entitled The Party Ain't Over. Please welcome, with special guest Jack White, Wanda Jackson.
One of the high points of Wanda's career was her induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 2009. And she was inducted by the daughter of a man she respected as much as anyone in the music business, Roseanne Cash.
Wanda Jackson. Even her name sounds like a declaration and a promise. Wanda Jackson. I asked Wanda what she wanted people to know most about her, and she said, number one, I can rock. Number two, I was a lady, and reputations are important. And number three, rock and roll and God are not mutually exclusive. As one writer noted, Wanda was there at the beginning of rock and roll, and for girls with guitars, myself included, Wanda was the beginning of rock and roll. Everyone who cares about roots music and rock and roll reveres Wanda, but in particular, every young woman I know, musician or otherwise, worships her as the prototype, the first female rock star, as she so modestly acknowledges herself. As Marshall Grant, one of the original Tennessee Two, my dad's bass player, said about her, she was the only woman back then who could hold her own with Elvis's crowd. She came off stage every night to a standing ovation. She was a little tiger out there. And as Bob Dylan noted, this is an atomic fireball of a lady. About tonight, she said that it feels good to be up there with my buddies. It's come full circle. So Wanda, you are now up there with your buddies, Carl, Elvis, Jerry Lee, and Johnny, and among so many others of your peers and those who have followed you. You are, as Wendell always introduces you, the first lady of rock and roll and the queen of rockabilly, and now a member of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Wanda Jackson.
If he brings you happiness, then I wish you all the best. It's your happiness that matters most of all. Wasted days and wasted nights that I have left for you behind. I can't remember when I didn't love you. There was a time I thought you felt the same. Holy one, you'll never know how much I love you so. And I'll be there before the next teardrop falls.
Freddie Fender, an artist that has always been near and dear to my heart. Still to come, friends, we don't forget, we have more of Rosie Flores, Marti Brom, Ruby Ann, and we're going to be talking to Tom Ingram about some of the women that he's booked at Viva Las Vegas. Once again, if you've enjoyed any part of this show, any of these series of shows, friends, if you could visit our virtual tip jar at stellarjacks.com, I tell you, it would do more good than you might even imagine. You can visit it right now if you like. Or if you want to stay watching the show, you can do it when we're finished here. Do it tomorrow or later in the week. But help in any way you can.
Without your donations, we can't go on doing this. So if you're enjoying it, let us know by visiting our virtual tip jar, StellarJackson.com. And now, dear viewers, a vocalist whose career began in Portugal, but has taken her quite literally around the world. Ladies and gentlemen, Ruby Ann, welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Well, thanks for stopping by, Ruby. It's been a little while since we've seen each other. We usually run into each other at one of the many festivals that you work with around the world. Yeah. You've been holding up all right during these nutty times?
Yeah, I guess it is what it is. You know, you have to stay inside. The festivals were all canceled, and we don't know what's coming up next. We'll see.
Okay, yeah. Well, for now, we're not going to look forward. We're looking back a little bit. As I mentioned, your career began in Portugal, and you kind of first came on my radar when you were with the band called the Boppin' Boozers. Was that where it started for you as a vocalist?
Yes. It was in 1997 that we started rehearsing, and in our first show was in Porto in 1998, October, I remember. That was a long time ago.
Well, you know, we've had a chance to hang out before. I know that like early on, Patsy Cline was an influence. Now, was it more her country stuff or some of the rockin' sides that she did?
I think that the first thing that touched me on Patsy Cline was her voice, because I would get shivers all over just listening to her voice. And I got influenced by everything. It was her country. It was because she didn't do much rock and roll or rockabilly. It was definitely one of the first female singers that I knew. Janis Martin and Wanda Jackson, of course, but I was blown away by Patsy Cline, and I did at the beginning a lot of covers of Patsy Cline. How dare I to do something?
Young and bold and fearless.
Yes, like fear of nothing.
Well, we've both had a chance to work with a lot of some of the acts that were famous in their day and some obscure ones. Are there any of the maybe some of the lesser known female artists that you found as to be an inspiration?
One that I remember, well, she's not famous, but Charline Arthur, she was like that woman was wearing pants back in those days. It was quite bold for a woman to do that on stage, you know? And that was kind of like that, how do you say? She was like a little rebel.
I've got the boogie woogie blues. Oh Lord, no one knows. I've got the boogie woogie blues. Well, when I went boogieing, I boogied on the floor. When I got through, I wanted to boogie some more. I've got the boogie woogie blues. I've got the
I'm glad you mentioned Charline Arthur, because when I talked to some of the older artists, they mentioned her as being an inspiration for the reasons that you mentioned, because she did have that rebel spirit and she went against the grain. She wasn't the typical female artist. And that kind of leads me to the next thing I wanted to ask you. It seems to me that you, more than some of the others, approach your music differently. Like I don't necessarily think of you as a female rockabilly. Like, to me, it seems that you were equally inspired by some of the male rockin' artists as you were the female.
Yes.
Is that true? Do you approach it that way?
I think it was, I'm not going to just be inspired by woman. And especially because in this music, or in any genres at the time and nowadays, mainly is a men's business. So I was inspired by everything, you know. You are inspired by everything you listen, and you listen to a lot of male rockabilly singers and country singers and male mainly. So,
well, to me, I think that approach has been a one of the great things about you. To me, that it really makes you stand out. But has that led to any resistance? Like, wait, that's not like a woman artist isn't supposed to be like that. You know, like I know Charline Arthur faced some resistance of her being the way she was. Have you encountered any of that along the way?
Well, when I started, I was in my early 20s, and there were not that many female singers in the rockabilly scene. You know them. You had Kim Lenz, you had the Ranch Girls, you had Marti Brom, and you had, well, maybe a few more that I don't remember right now. But
you've grown as an artist. Your career has expanded. Where not only in life, being a mother now, which is a whole responsibility I know of its own. And as a matter of fact, I know that was a factor in our scheduling you for the show. But also you've also grown beyond just being an artist to working with a lot of artists. Like you handle a lot of the artists at a lot of the major rockabilly festivals all around the world. Any experiences in working with some of those artists that stand out and maybe particular with some of the female artists?
I actually enjoy more working behind the scenes than being on stage, because I get really nervous nowadays, and I haven't been performing not even half as much as I used to, because I lived from music for a few years and then I got pregnant, you know, and you can't just go on the road with a big belly, and it's not a lifestyle for a pregnant lady or having a baby.
You know, as you were talking, Ruby, I was thinking it must be quite a thing for you, having started out as a young lady, kind of trying to timidly maybe working your way into the scene, to find yourself working, to standing alongside some of your heroes. How does that feel?
Well, it kind of, if I look back, it feels very surreal, because when I started, I was listening to these guys on records, you know. It's like, I remember listening, buying the High Noon album and coming home and putting on the record player and listening to that. And a few years later, you know, I'm talking with these guys, like they're my buddies and they respect me as a fellow musician, which I don't even know how is that possible, but it's great. Like you, for example. Well, like I'm talking about others. Like you're one of the biggest example. Come on, Big Sandy. I known you since I was 5, 10 years ago. But
well, there's a younger generation of artists, even younger than you, Ruby Ann.
Way younger.
who will be influenced by you and like you, not admit it.
maybe.
No, yeah. No, but really, yeah, you've set the pace for the next generation and the generation after that. So you're part of the story now, and that's a beautiful thing.
Oh, that's a huge compliment. Thank you.
Well deserved. Now, Ruby, I'm wondering if there are any of the young up and coming women artists that you think are particularly noteworthy.
Well, I listen to so many records of demos and people sending me stuff for the festivals that I work, especially Viva Las Vegas, of course, and for the label. And I wish there were more girls singing, because there's not that many. There's a few that, and I don't know if they're brand new because they've been for a while. One of them that pops my mind is like Anita from Spain. Yes. Anita O'Knight from Spain. I think she's great. And the other ones that have been around, like I was thinking about Amber, but Amber's been around forever, like more singing for longer than I did.
Well, she still has that youthful spirit though.
And, you know, she, I guess,
well, she's part of the show as well. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well.
how about on Ruby Records? Have you put, are there any female acts that you've released on your label?
So, Bailey D for sure. Like, that woman knows how to sing. She knows how to play the guitar. She writes her own songs. She's got everything.
Well, to me, and I'm hoping we can, and I think we are going to touch on her influence on this whole thing. To me, she's like a modern day version of like Sister Rosetta Tharpe, because she can, even when she's singing a secular song, you feel the gospel thing, and she's like wailing away on the guitar. Yeah, she's pretty badass.
You know, that crowd was getting bigger than I could bear. Before I knew what happened, that whole city was a day. I did a tiptoe.
Well, Ruby, it's been really great to catch up with you here on the show. I'll be looking forward to the time that we can all be hanging together, that you can all be trying to herd us like cats. And you take care of yourself and your family there, and give my love to Dean, please. All right.
Yes, it will. Yeah. It will be done. All right. Bye bye. Thank you so much. Until next time. Hopefully all soon. Right.
Now we'd like to bring on a man who's been an integral part of the rockabilly scene for many years, starting in the UK, where he used to DJ and put on shows of his own, which led up to a gigantic rockabilly festival called Hemsby Rock and Roll Weekender, which then led to him moving to the United States and kicking off Viva Las Vegas that we all know and love. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Tom Ingram.
Hello, it's good to be here.
As I mentioned, you started out in the UK DJing and putting on your own events. What year about did you start booking your own shows and putting on events in the UK?
My very first shows was actually probably when I was just 18, just old enough to go in pubs legally. And I rented the room at the back of a pub called the Swan and Sugarloaf in Croydon. And then I'd just get a friend of mine to take the money on the door, and I DJed, and that was it. That was the start.
All right.
It all came from there.
It seemed like it kind of snowballed from there, because even here in the United States, I started to hear word, a lot of us did, of record hops going on over there in London, and made us really jealous, made us want to be over there, because we had a smaller scene, but very passionate, but it wasn't as organized. And you seem to have been such an important part of organizing the scene, not only there, but then, eventually here. And I know over the course of that time, you've had a chance to work with a lot of the women within the rockabilly scene, a lot of the original artists. I remember reading about a specific night where you booked Rose Maddox, and it ended up being a star-studded event. You want to tell us about that?
It was actually Glenn and Rose Maddox.
Okay.
A place called the Camden Workers Club, which was, it was an old school hall that got turned into a working man's club. And I was DJing it every Thursday, then had this opportunity for Glenn and Rose Maddox. So I took it. And we used to get, for the record hops, we'd get about 300 people on a Thursday night. And I remember that night, there was a line to get in, and people were running down the street to get into the show to make sure they didn't miss out.
Wow.
And we had all sorts of people showed up. Robert Plant turned up with a group of his friends.
Okay. Robert Plant, huh?
The Robert Plant, yeah. Then also John Peel. He turned up that night, if people know who he is.
And that's quite an attraction anyway. I mean, even within the scene and from the outsiders as well, Glenn and Rose Maddox. Now with Rose, in her case, I know she kind of came out of the hillbilly scene, but she did some really rocking tracks of her own.
Take me where beneath the moon. Take me in your Cadillac and we'll go honky-tonking.
Particularly love when you had Janis Martin on the bill. I know you've booked her at various times, but there was one like really magical night where you had Janis Martin and her idol, Ruth Brown, on the bill. Any special stories you have about that that night in Long Beach?
Yes. I don't know if you know that Janis Martin had never met Ruth Brown.
I didn't know that.
She'd idolized her all these years. Ruth Brown was Janis's idol from when she was like in her early teens, and had never met her. And so we put this show on, and I remember the moment they met, and it was just outside one of the hotel rooms at the venue. And the look on Janis's face was, you know, you could see that it was like a lifelong ambition finally had happened.
Well, I'm getting chills right now hearing you say that, because I was tearing up that night, because when you brought them on stage together, you know, when they came out together, it was really one of the magical moments of my rock and roll lifetime. Janis was really open and expressing her love and the inspiration that Ruth Brown was to her.
Ruth Brown she knew of Janis Martin, but
right.
Because Janis Martin was much younger than Ruth Brown. But Ruth Brown was really easy to deal with, and I became good friends with her and her son. But when she did Viva, I dealt with her directly and explained it all to her. And right up to the moment before she went on stage, she said to me, if they throw tomatoes at me, I'm going to blame you. And I said, don't worry, they're not going to throw anything at you. They're going to love you. And she said, are you sure? I said, yes, no question about it. But it turned out that was a massive understatement, because the reaction and the love from the audience was far, far more than anyone could even have imagined. And she was blown away by it. And, she, you know, as you remember,
yeah.
She was in tears. The whole audience was in tears because, you know, when she was saying about how she'd been ill and she never expected to perform again, and here she was.
Here she is, a true, true legend. Ruth Brown, really let her know, friends. Come on. Wait a minute now. Yeah, come on. I'll tell you what.
Thank you.
I'll tell you what. Should we see if we can get Janis up here too?
Janis, maybe I'll cover this. This is the very first time that I've met Janis. We've spoken to each other on phones, and she said that she knew all of my music, and she does not really look that old, does she?
If I can say something here, there must have been something in that water in Virginia.
Yeah,
to, you know what I mean?
We're yeah. Both from Virginia, you know that.
Let them know.
This is my lady. She has made me what I am today. Oh my God. Thank you, baby. Thank you, young people. Thank you, young people. I really appreciate you even taking time to listen to the music of what I've been 55 years doing. Thank you so much.
Mama, would you show?
Women acts, as they get older, their voices don't deteriorate the same way as men's voices do. No, I mean, a lot older than you are now.
Yeah. Although, Tom, you know that a lot of these 50s acts, when they first started coming back around, being rediscovered, they were younger than we are now, you know?
I know.
So that's weird to think about, man.
Yeah. Elvis was way younger than I am now when he died.
Yeah. She was like one of the bigger names in music at one point when you had Brenda Lee at the car show. Yeah. I mean, she was like a legitimate star, you know, not like, you know, some of these other rockabilly acts are fantastic, but in their time, they were just local musicians, you know, just trying to taking their swing at stardom, but never quite getting there. But Brenda Lee was legitimate. Did you get a chance to like hang out with her or get a sense of her personality at all?
No. One of my biggest regrets with Viva Las Vegas is it's because it's so big and there's so much work. I've never really had the chance to spend time with acts as much as I wanted.
Right.
And so I missed some great photo opportunities. So with Brenda Lee, yeah, I had a brief chat with her and she was very friendly and accommodating. And she too seemed surprised at the age group of the crowd.
Yeah. I mentioned that you've had stars on the stage and maybe lesser known artists. When Laura Lee Perkins was there, that's somebody I thought I would never see. Somebody, records that we all came to love through the Imperial Rockabilly albums. But I never would have dreamt in a million years that I'd get a chance to see her. How did you end up tracking her down?
Someone gave me the phone number.
Just, yeah.
I can't remember who it was now. So I just phoned her up and said, look, do you want to come and do this show, basically?
Yeah.
And I explained that people wanted all her old songs. And she said, okay. And she blew everyone away. She was so good.
She was fantastic, yeah. Another one who has sadly passed on, you know, we've been losing so many of them. So, Tom, how often has Wanda performed at Viva Las Vegas? And
I actually can't remember how many times she's played for me at Viva.
I love a mean, mean man who lives uptown. When I want him most, he's not around. He's a mean, mean man. Woo, Lord, he's a mean, mean man. He's a mean. But I love him all I can. Now he calls at 7, wants a date at 8. He's never on time, he's always late. He's a mean, mean man. Ooh, Lord, he's a mean, mean man. I'm talking about you. He's a mean, mean man, but I love him all I can.
I mean, I think everybody loves Wanda Jackson, but it seems like the women, especially the young ladies, are really... I've always been really drawn to her. I'm sure you've noticed that as well.
Yeah, and I think the women are drawn to the women singers anyway. But in the case of Wanda Jackson, she performed so much, so people got to meet her more.
Right.
And had more of a relationship with her as opposed to just someone they know of. At the moment, we've got a ton of female acts on the scene, and some of them are really, really good. So it's good to see, and as you've noticed, I've always included, they deserve to be there. It's as simple as that. Once you have like women performing, that encourages more women to start performing.
Absolutely.
Which gives us more acts to play the event. And so it's all about empowering people to follow their dreams. no matter what their sex, race, color, or anything. Just, yeah, everyone's as good as each other. The term rockabilly is encompassing all 50s music. In England, we just called it all rock and roll. The problem here is when you talk about rock and roll, now you get talking about the Rolling Stones, AC/DC, and all that sort of music. So that's what rock and roll is in the USA. So that's why I think that rockabilly has become the word to describe all 50s music.
Any promising up-and-coming artists of note that you might that you can think of?
There's a few that are at different sort of stages within their career of playing rockabilly. Someone like Ruby Ann, who has been around for a number of years now and is very popular, and she still is. You know, when she performs, people go and see her, and she still does a great job. One of the more recent ones that I was really impressed when I first saw her was Anita O'Knight and the Mercury Trio. And I don't know if you've seen her, have you?
Yes. Oh, she's fantastic. Yeah.
Yeah. Really, really good. And I think she's got a lot of possibilities in the future of doing, you know, becoming a big act on the scene. And she's easy to deal with and a nice person, which I always think is so important. We're looking at the broader spectrum of rockabilly, like we were just saying about how the word is more than just strict rockabilly. Obviously, Tammy Savoy's come onto the scene in a big way, and you know, working everywhere. So you know, she's doing a great job, and I think she's got a lot of a big future ahead of her.
Want me to love you, you gotta love me too. If you want me to hug you, you gotta hug me too. Cause I ain't giving up nothing if I can't get something from you. If you want me to kiss you, you gotta kiss me too. If you want me,
someone who's sort of like exploded on the scene more recently is a harder sort of rockabilly, and that's the Screaming Rebel Angels, the lead singer, Laura Palmer.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And what I like about her, apart from how she's great on stage, is that, I don't know if anyone realizes this, she records all her own music, she mixes her own music, she does the artwork for the CDs and LPs, she edits her own videos. She's got her own publishing company. She does absolutely everything. And so it's a good example of what someone can do if they put their minds to it. Not just a girl, but you know, guys can do it as
well.
And really have complete control. And the band is hers. She gets the musicians to play with her.
Well, you also have a presence with a radio show. Can you tell us a little bit about what you're doing with that?
Yeah, I've done radio shows since 1984, I think, was my first one. And now I'm doing it on Rockabilly Radio, which is an internet-based radio station that you can hear everywhere. And I do a weekly show on a Saturday that's then repeated during the week. Thank you. It's great chatting with you, and see you again soon.
Thanks so much, Tom. We'll talk to you soon, my man.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Take care.
All right.
Hey, Memphis, won't you?
Rock, 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 rock rock-a-bye, boogie, rock-a-bye, boogie, rock-a-bye, rock-a-bye, boogie, rock-a-bye.
There was no woman who made a home in a great big broken down shoe. She had so doggone many kids, she didn't know what to do. So come on, baby, go to sleep and shut your eyes and blue.
Rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, boogie, rock a bye, rock a bye, boogie, 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 he's my lover, he's my only one. He's the one that drives me wild. He's the one that sets my soul on fire. He's my lover, my love. He's my lover, he's my only one.
Well, there you go. That was fun to watch, wasn't it? Something old, something new. A lot of those, my friends, so good to see them on the screen. And I was reminded how many remarkable artists there are these days. A lot of the women are putting together some fantastic videos and just doing some great work. Do you agree with me? If you do, maybe you can help them out. If you visit our virtual tip jar at stellarjacks.com, you can help some of the guests that we've had on this show, on the previous shows. It helps us continue this production. Even watching this, I have some suggestions for future shows. I'm wondering if anybody out there has any suggestions for future topics, other artists we might want to feature. And if you do, please drop us a line, either in the comments here.
And now I'd like to bring onto the show a woman who is widely acknowledged as being one of the great voices within the rockabilly and country music realm. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Marti Brom.
Hello, Robert.
Hi, Marti. It's lovely to see you. I guess you're coming to us from Austin right now?
I'm outside Rosie Flores' apartment in Austin, Texas.
Do you remember a point in your life where maybe a turning point where it changed from just listening to it to where you start to have ideas of maybe doing it yourself? And how did that come about?
Well, I mean, I always had ideas of doing it myself, even when I was really small. But I don't know. I sang a long time in my bedroom to records because I had stage fright so badly. I tried to perform in front of people when I was in high school, and I got physically ill, and I was like, oh, this is what this is like. I can't do it. But I got over that after I performed in a play at a Air Force base in Illinois, and it basically took one time with people, you know, enjoying it and me enjoying it to kind of get over that. I mean, it was still years and years and years of performing and singing and playing out that you get comfortable completely with it. So,
well, you know, Marti, you know, on this episode, we're talking about some of the great women, the ladies of the rockabilly scene. And I've had a chance to ask some of our guests about some of their early influences, any women from within the rockabilly or early rock and roll realm, was an early inspiration. Some people have, you know, mentioned, you know, Patsy Cline and, of course, Wanda Jackson. Anybody like that moved you early on?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I sang a lot of folk type of stuff, and I really loved that sort of thing. You know, it was before my parents didn't listen to country music, and I had to kind of find that on my own watching Hee Haw and the Porter Wagoner Show, and I really was kind of gravitated toward that, but I also really liked rock and roll, and I think I discovered Suzy Quatro when I was 13. I lived in Italy.
Yeah.
And it was kind of like, oh my God, I didn't know that women sang this stuff, you know, because I was so used to hearing more folky kind of, you know, girls with acoustic guitars singing. And so when I discovered her, when I got back to the U.S. when I was like 14, I searched her out and was like, oh my God. So really, for me, the first real rock and roll, like, female artist I discovered was Suzy Quatro.
With women artists, with a lot of them, with the really good ones, they're comfortable with what they do, and there's no challenge going on. And I think there's a certain camaraderie that maybe some of the guys don't have. I tell you, well, you've always been a great interpreter of other people's material, including the original songs, but you've interpreted a lot of Terry Joyce's songs. And they've been fantastic, but it's really wonderful to hear something that is written by you. I mean, you're writing for your own voice, and so it's purely you. So I just want to say how wonderful that is. You're coming to us live from outside of Rosie Flores' place, and I understand that you might be able to do a song for us here with Rosie. Is that is that possible?
Yeah, we're gonna do the song that I just said, that one of the songs I recorded for the EP. Because there's kind of a little backstory. It's called Get in the Car, Loretta. And I basically wrote this song more than 20 years ago about a scene in the movie Sweet Dreams between Patsy Cline and Loretta Lynn. And so I thought this was a good song because, you know, those two women played together, were best friends, you know, great friends until, you know, Patsy's untimely demise.
Dear viewers, a true American classic, a woman who's been an inspiration to so many throughout the years, both in music and in spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, Rosie Flores.
Ta-da!
Hi, Rosie. Well, I tell you, it is an honor to have not one, but two Ameripolitan Rockabilly female winners. What an honor.
Oh, I'm so glad to be here with Marti.
So Rosie, I think, well, there's a lot of people that know and love you, and a lot of people might
really
know this, but absolutely. you're originally from San Antonio, Texas.
Yes, that's right.
Now, how early did you have musical aspirations? Was that right off the bat?
Started when I, just right out of the womb. I was going, "Wah, yeah."
Okay.
No, okay. My dad was instrumental in getting me inspired to sing into a tape recorder.
Okay.
And so that was around age 7. So a lot of recordings. In fact, on the Rockabilly Philly record,
yes,
there's one where I'm singing when I'm 7 years old. And but it was all like sort of jazz tunes, like American Standard songs were happening back in that day.
Okay.
You know, in the 50s when I was like 56, 57. And right after that, then came Hound Dog and Jerry Lee, a whole lot of shaking going on. And so my brother, who was the 2 years older than me, he would record those songs into my dad's tape recorder, little two-track. And we would do that after dinner. We'd clear the table and put the two-track on and grab the Hit Parade and start. That's where all the lyrics were, so we could record with the lyrics right there, all the pop songs that were hot on the radio at the time. So, you know, I was blessed with good pitch, you know, so even as a little girl, I could sing on key, you know. And so that was, I think, why I fell into the whole, I fell in love with music, because it just felt good to do, you know. When I was 14, I started my 14, 15, a girl singing group that was sort of like the Ronettes, but I was one of the background singers. And we were called Dora and the Debs. And
I didn't know about
two
that.
2 years later, I started an all-girl band.
I know about Penelope's Children after
yeah,
that.
Then I started Penelope's Children, exactly. California.
What sort of sound would we have been hearing coming from Penelope's Children? Was it just like the sound of the day, of like a folk rock or psychedelic?
We were very influenced by everything from the Everly Brothers to the Jefferson Airplane and Jimi Hendrix, you know?
Okay.
So we were kind of country meets psychedelic, which we were like one of the very first country rock bands.
Okay.
And we toured at age 18. We got in a little VW bus, and we toured from San Diego to San Antonio, and we played the Kit Kat Club, and we got like press and everything, and we did. That was our first little tour, but we were billed as country rock. Was it Russell Scott and Donna Lindley? We started a band there, remember, called Rosie and the Reverbs?
Yeah, I do remember.
We started covering a lot of Janis Martin stuff, and James would sing too in High School Confidential. We just used to get to rock the joint there. And from there, I moved into I was still on High Tone Records, and I wanted to do a rockabilly record. And that's when I invited Wanda Jackson and Janis Martin to sing two duets each with me on that record. And that kind of broke me into the, put me into the rockabilly genre. That's when people started calling me the Rockabilly Philly.
Well, not only did it kind of bring you more into that genre, you also helped to reignite their careers and led to like...
Yes. It helped both of us.
But it led to like, you know, doing further... opportunities to work together with both of them separately. Tell us about some of your experiences with Wanda, since we're featuring her here on the show.
Oh yeah. Wanda Jackson. She is the queen. She is Queenie. She is the queen of rockabilly. Back in her era, Elvis talked her into doing rock and roll because she was recording as a country artist, you know, with a cowboy hat and the fringe and everything. And he said, you know, Wanda, you really, with your voice, you really should sing rock and roll. And he taught her how to sing good rockin' tonight. And it just like exploded. She was like, she was great at it and her producers loved it. And so that's when she did that whole era and then has inspired so many people, from me to Chrissy Hynde to Marti Brom and everybody else, Ronnie Spector. I mean, all these females have been influenced by what she did back in those days. And actually, I spoke with her granddaughter today and heard that she's just doing great. You know, she's been doing some recording. She's recording with for Joan Jett's label. We have no idea when that's going to come out or anything, but she was did do some recording with that. And her health is great. And so, yeah, you know.
Well, I'll tell you, Rosie, I think it's a really a true sign of your character as an artist that you took the time to show, to put them in the spotlight a little bit, reinvigorating their career. And in Janice's case, giving her a little bit of joy before she passed on into the other world. It's nice to know that she moved on with feeling good about the recordings that she did with you. You know, I tell you what, you think you can play a song for us? And
sure.
That would be a treat if you could sing a song for us here, Rosie.
That would be great.
All right, this one for you, Big Sandy. I recorded this song that Wanda Jackson recorded many years ago. It's called I Gotta Know. Are you ready, Marti Brom?
I'm ready.
One, two, three, two, two. If our eyes fail, where is my
Rosie, thank you so much for being here today. You're truly a treasure, an Ameripolitan classic. You've helped to reignite some of the careers of your idols, and you, in turn, continue to be an idol to many. So thank you for spending time with us, Rosie.
There's a lot going on around this big old world in the rockabilly scene, and our musicians are as far away as Brazil, England, and Portugal, but they all share one thing in common. They're all out of work. No festivals, no tours, and no local gigs to fall back on. All they have is the appreciation of fans like you to help them get by. If you're feeling entertained by this episode of Eclectic American Roots, please chip in to the tip jar. We promise that we'll get to the artists on the show right away. So dig deep and show your appreciation. Did you ever think that banks would ever encourage you to enter like this? Please wear a mask and protect the ones you love. And we'll see you on the next episode of Eclectic American Roots.